Put your mic back on. Let's see who's working with.
All right, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Am I echoing? Do I sound crazy? Melanated gender piece. You can hear me.
Hey, Scar Beauty. Pray!
So real quick, can you hear me?
Been fighting to save your microwave, my brother.
Do I sound okay?
Hold on. Yeah. Say that again.
Do I sound okay?
Yes, you sound great.
All right, I'm mic'd up.
Yay! So, we've been live 5 minutes. Craig and Melanated is here. So, we gonna put on another song.
Craig, peace. Melanated, peace.
You got to know when to hold them. Know when to fold them. Know when to walk away. Know when to run. You better count your money. Ooh, wrong song. I'm playing.
Might be the right song for the night.
True, true. Boom shakalaka. Y'all excuse me for my random outburst, but they make sense to me. Oh yeah. 1 + 1 = 2. Always and forever. And if it wasn't him, then it's you. Yes, sir. Here we go. I need an assistant. Shit, if I had an assistant, my assistant would need an assistant. Excuse my language, y'all. Sometimes I just, let me know if anybody else come in because I'm on another screen, please.
Gary, what up?
Gary!
Beans with those, Gary. They pinto beans.
Hold on. What'd you say, Jaden?
Now, Gary's talking about eating bison and beans. I wonder if there's pinto beans. I feel like pinto beans go with bison.
Yeah, it's down about right, yeah.
Pinto beans go with cornbread, so I would assume.
Well, all beans go with cornbread, don't they?
I don't know, man.
I would say the answer to that is yeah.
I don't know. Pinto beans, the truth. You have proved them repentant. You will stand. I will love you forever. You know I can. I need you. Truth. I need you.
You was right, pinto beans.
Telling you, can't beat a nice pinto bean. I tried fava beans once, they was nasty. Can anyone guess why I tried fava beans? What movie was I watching on Friday?
Probably a Western.
Nah, it wasn't Western. We are going to talk about, you know, it's kind of wild, like, cause the Netflix just came out with the what's the name of that movie, The Harder They Fall. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
And there's not, you know, and that kind of brought up the discussion how, you know, there's not much black representation in Westerns.
Mm-hmm.
I tried Venison one time, Gary. I liked it when I tried it. The first time, the second time I was, but it was like venison jerky, so I ain't.
Yeah,
tried, like,
you have to real, try real steel venison. Sausage.
But I enjoyed it. I was watching Silence of the Lambs, Melon Agenda. You're right.
Fava beans and an ice Chianti.
I was, but like, I wonder what fava beans taste like.
I'm still on the hunt for whatever it is. I feel like it's hiding from me on my own damn channel, and I was on the phone with Jaded. And I came across this thing that I had read. What was it? 2017. Yeah. 2017. About this dude that's up on the screen right now, William Ellis. So me and Jaden started digging on his side, and then we poking around and we found some stuff. So we figured we'd just come and tell y'all, since it is, you know, still Black History Month. This is what we was gonna do on Saturday, but my stomach said not this week. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so, that's what it did.
And it's always good to take a break and come back. You know? And you know, we have this tale in our quest to bring you obscure aspects of Black history. We have a tale of Mr. Allegio, otherwise known as William H. Ellis. And William H. Ellis was born a slave
in Texas,
died a millionaire. So Tripp, you want to get into this?
Is that really accurate though?
Well, he died a thousandaire.
Yeah, you know, they tried to make it sound a little bit more grand, but I get that back then that was a good sum of money.
A lot of money. If you was a thousandaire back then, it felt like a millionaire.
Yeah. So, yeah. So, in our quest to find out more about this man that looks like the Black version of Whipless Nightlash, we ran across this book written in 2016 by this guy named, what was his name? Carl Jacoby?
Carl Jacoby.
Yes, Carl Jacoby. Called
The Texas Slave. What is it called?
The Texas Slave.
Or Mick something.
Something like that. Hold, I'm trying to get the whole name because it's long. Shoot.
Yeah, it's one of those, it's one of those long books.
Mm-hmm. And it wouldn't be so bad if we stayed on topic. Here we go. But as everybody at the treehouse knows, we never stay on topic. We'll always take that left at Albuquerque, but we always get back on the road. So William Henry Ellis, U.S. slave who became a millionaire by pretending to be Mexican. Before anybody jumps down my throat about
proper... You're going to use the word Mexican in this show.
This is the name of the book. Okay, so William Henry Ellis, also known as Guillermo Enrique Elicio, was a former African-American slave who found his way around the racist Jim Crow system by pretending to be of different ethnicity. The former slave would become one of the most successful Mexican, in quotation, businessmen of the early 20th century. Oh, the academic shade.
The early 20th century. What a time.
Mm-hmm.
You could very similar to right now in many ways.
Yes. William Henry Ellis was born in Victoria, Texas in 1864, 1 year before slavery was abolished. Ellis grew up around Mexicans and quote unquote, Tejanos at a cotton plantation and became fluent in Spanish. He would become the assistant and Spanish translator of William McNamara, a powerful Irish merchant. Crystal, you are not on dialogue tonight. Get out the window. At the age of 20, Ellis moved to San Antonio and became involved in the cotton and hide business. Ellis told his new contacts in newspaper outlets that his name was Guillermo Enrique Elicio of Mexican origin. His olive skin and fluency in Spanish helped Ellis blend in with the Mexican and Tejano population. As a businessman who was regularly on the move, Ellis's new identity helped him travel on train with similar commodities as white travelers, which was the main precipitous to him passing as Hispanic, something Crystal. If it's on the road, it ain't got no business with you. Okay? You still there, Jaden?
I am.
Okay, just making sure, just making sure. In 1889, Ellis traveled to Mexico City and met with several high-ranking members of President Porfirio Diaz's government. He convinced them to allow him to build a colony of 20,000 African Americans by claiming that African Americans were the best cotton pickers in the world, end quote. The best cotton pickers in the world, end quote. The project was canceled when Ellis was not able to secure enough funding. In 1894, Ellis resumed his colonization plan and moved almost 1,000 African Americans. You will have to help me out with that name.
I can't see it. Wait a minute. Let me find it.
T-L-A-H-U-A.
Oh, yeah. The Tlahalilo.
Yeah, Durango.
Tlahalilo, Durango.
Yes, to work for La Compañía Agrícola Limitada del... Hey, Cosmo. Ellis ecstatically expressed that, quote, he had lived to see African Americans in the country of God and liberty, end quote. His dream crumbled, though, as disease and poor living conditions drove most of the colonizers to return to the United States. That's a unique thing to call some black folk colonizers. Oh my goodness.
Well, technically.
A 1,000 black people. Ellis decided to move to New York after it was revealed in San Antonio that he was African American. A letter C for colored was placed next to his name. The mattress ain't did shit to you. Quit beating it. Was placed next to his name on the new phone book directory. It's like she got an emergency order for biscuits or some shit. In 1904.
Like the scarlet letter, right?
What?
Color.
Oh, yes. C for colored. Mm. In 1904, Ellis bought a seat in Wall Street. Wall Street was obsessed with investing in Mexico. And Ellis was very well connected with Porfirio Diaz's government. Ellis would become president of several mining and rubber companies, all deeply invested in Mexico. He would then purchase the biggest furniture store in Mexico and became Mexico's representative for the Hotchkiss Arms Company. Ellis then proceeded to marry a white woman of humble background named Maud Sherwood and had six children. Say what, Jaden?
You got a what?
A white woman of humble background named Maud Sherwood.
Of what background?
Humble.
Humble? What's that mean? That means she was broke?
Humble. Yes, basically. Well, I don't know about completely broke, but not rich. Certainly not rich.
Goodness gracious.
They had six children, two which passed away shortly after birth. In a press release, Ellis also fabricated Sherwood's background and stated that she belonged to British nobility. During the Mexican Revolution, Ellis suffered economic losses and contracts he had signed with the Diaz government. When Mexican President Venustiano Carranza was overthrown by Alvaro Obregón, Ellis accompanied Carranza as he fled Mexico City. In 1923, Ellis worked with President Obregón to reduce tariffs at ports in order to attract more business. On Saturday, September 24th, 1923, Ellis passed away in Mexico City and was buried in El Panteón Español in a grave without a name. A few years later, his wife and children permanently moved to Mexico. His descendants still live in Mexico and are known as the Elisios. They are affluent and successful Mexicans who were not aware of Ellis's African-American background until Carl Jacoby, author of Ellis's autobiography, arranged a family reunion between the Mexican Elisios and the American Ellises. In 2015, Ellis's great-grandnephew, Chip Williams, who lives in the United States, was invited to Ellis's great-granddaughter's wedding in Tepoztlán, Mexico. The biography is titled The Strange Career of William Ellis, the Slave Who Became a Mexican Millionaire, and can be purchased on Amazon if you are so inclined.
So, there's a lot to unpack in this little tale.
Yes.
Now, there was this, let's get into this first, right? This history of black people.
Oh, wait. For those of you that have been here for a while and y'all wondering, what video did you do about this? Remember the one where I was talking about the black people that went to Mexico and they got sick and shit? They was out there and the non-proper housing and the subpar tools and stuff, and they had to end up going back, and the consulate had to end up sending them back to Alabama and Georgia. That's this dude. This is the dude that did that shit. But continue, Jaden.
Yes. Well, I was getting into that. That's what I wanted to address. Like, we have in the early 20th century, this history in the late 19th century, this history of promises of some type of utopia outside of the United States, mm-hmm. right? So, you know, and you know, it runs
Mexico
the gambit.
Was like, seen as the land of liberty and freedom. Right, like,
so we've talked about Garvey in Africa. We've talked about Gordon in Mongolia. We haven't talked about within the Mortar Science Temple, there were plans to go to Turkey. There was, you know, there was all types of escape plans to go to different places, right? Mm-hmm. And what ends up happening in 9 times out of 10, it's a scam. It's not what it's presented to be.
Mm-hmm.
So like
I'm still looking for the one where they went to, where was it, Puerto Rico or Costa Rica? I'm still looking for that one, but I stumbled across this one.
Right. Somebody else was talking about going to Costa Rica to start a Egyptian Japanese.
That would be Young Pharaoh.
Right. Mm-hmm. We've had Nature Boy.
Yes.
Did we watch out to Costa Rica, didn't he?
Did we watch our windmill for the week? I don't think we did.
Did we?
I don't think we did.
We may have.
I don't know.
You so want to watch? We can windmill. You want a windmill? Let's windmill.
Well, which one is it?
I think
that's the. Oh, did y'all get to catch the debate last night between General Little Spoon and Dr. NK? Did you catch it, Jaded?
I caught it. It was pretty funny. I tried to hold in my laughter as much as I could, but I couldn't hold it.
Great Queen Ethereum showed it to me later, and I was like, wow, is this what y'all do when I'm not around?
Yeah, I don't, you know, like they start tripping, you know. That's why I try to keep General Inky to, you know. I don't let him use the camera that much, man. I don't let NK use the camera that often because he starts tripping. So there's as much camera time as he's gotten along, you know. Period.
Debating between THC cookies. Are we supposed to be windmilling?
Oh, right. We were windmilling for Sparrow this week.
Was it? I don't see it. No, there you go. Oh, it's because you used a different, yeah, that's right. Okay, hold on. Here we go. It's snowing in Lancaster. Oh my!
Damn that!
Right.
I'm pretty much over snow.
Here to defend the general, the smartest man in the whole universe, the smartest black man in the world, the best lawyer. I'm here to defend Young Pharaoh. That's right. I'm here to defend Young Pharaoh, Sammy. And the first
But see, this is what I don't understand is, okay, you was windmilling for Pharaoh last week, and then he just turned around and challenged to a debate. Well, Dr. NK to a debate.
Well, you know, he's unstable.
True.
Man, listen, I feel like I don't want to be in Michigan. Like I did Minnesota, I did Illinois.
What are you talking about, Michigan for Gary?
Pretty much over the Midwest. Oh, that was a side conversation I'm having with brother Gary. My apologies.
No, I'm saying Gary ain't in Michigan. Gary in Illinois, not shit. Gary in California. Excuse me.
I thought Lancaster was in Michigan.
No, there's a Lancaster in California too.
Oh shit.
Yeah, but okay. So for those of y'all that don't know, Lil Spoon lost last night on a technicality because there was supposed to be no move kazoot used during the debate. And we could all clearly see that powder on his nose has some powder on his nose. So
plus Dr. Inke proved that CMOS by way of Hebrew geometry, was in fact
technically Dr. NK won by default. But neither one of them actually proved shit. I don't even know what the damn debate was about. But anyway, Sparrow sent in a message and he said, y'all playing in my top. And y'all better stop.
Well, Dr. Inke wanted to let everybody know that speaking of tops, he is selling sea moss infused mushroom tops.
Lord Jesus. Okay, but let's get back to windmilling.
There's a lot of rappers with dreads who can't rap. So if you have a problem with Young Pharaoh rapping and Fledlock, what I want to say is, there's a lot of rappers with dreads who can't rap and yelling like, oh yeah!
Ooh, you know what'd be hot? Jaded. If I could make it float like Miss Cleo used to do back in the day.
Which one?
This.
Float?
Float. Like too big for skinny jeans across the background. You know how I did the video?
Yeah. Yeah. How you do that? How would you do that?
I don't know. I just said it'd be dope if I could.
Gotta work on that. Gotta brainstorm on that.
Yeah. Yeah.
Who do that? So, number one, Young Pharaoh's music for whoever likes Young Pharaoh's music. And if you don't like Young Pharaoh's music, then that's you're not on that vibration. So you can't say it's whack. You just have to say
your screen name make me giggle every time.
Vibration. Who Pharaoh is, and
you're not
too really big. And singers in Michigan. That's right. That's a fact.
Big Cobra statue, and the Cobra just stands
there. But he acknowledges and owns that fact.
Nobody. How many people do you know that have their own library, that have books that cost $100? Most of you don't even pay $10.99 on Amazon for books. You don't even have any books on your Kindle. He has whole library books, like books that you can find in a library. He has those kind of books, and you don't have those books. You don't. So you can't say that you're smarter than Young Pharaoh. Like books that you can find in a library. He has those kind of books. And this point is very serious.
I have never seen a scholar with a tongue.
Okay.
Thank you.
Understand this.
With a tongue like a monitor lizard. I've never seen that personally. Oh, wait, let me think.
And every four Americans.
Not on this plane.
Yes. Monitor lizard. No.
So. If you have a problem with Young Pharaoh,
don't forget to hit that notification bell
of the American population over 18. And most of the Young Pharaoh are fans, you're under 18. So, you know, really, if you're over 18 and you don't understand Young Pharaoh, then you just need to mind your business. You just don't understand. You're not, like I said, you're not vibrating on that level. And that's why you don't understand why he defends President Trump. Even though he doesn't seem to know anything about, because you just don't understand. You're not, like I said, you're not vibrating on that level. It really doesn't matter if he doesn't know anything about politics, because he has $1,500 books. So if he wanted to know about politics, he would buy a $1,500 book about politics, or he would buy Trump's book. It doesn't matter if two mentally ill people decide to support each other in their endeavors.
Where did that come from?
It just doesn't matter.
Lord.
If mentally ill people want to support each other, it's okay. It's not our business.
Yo, they still watching that Clarence video.
What Young Pharaoh said.
Yeah, yo, they're going to watch it forever. You're going to be mad.
So you need to just get some shrooms. So a lot of people say that Young Pharaoh's on drugs and he's going crazy and he's pulling guns out, but Young Pharaoh doesn't do drugs. Young Pharaoh doesn't do drugs. Drugs and he's going crazy and he's pulling guns out. You can't understand the type of shit that gangsters do. So, you know, gangsters, they respect, because, you know, Trump, he got a lot of gangsters out of prison, you know, and Trump, you know, he's a gangster. You can't understand the type of shit that gangsters do. And some people too, so you know, they have that in common. So, you know, a lot of times people don't understand that there's a camaraderie in scamming. So you have to understand that's part of understanding that they may have, and that he's trying to push you guys onto. So if you're not down with gangster shit, then, you know, you really can't judge Young Pharaoh. Just like Pac said, only God can judge him. And his guy's a black one. And you know how black women feel about Young Pharaoh. You know, around the time when Young Pharaoh got out of jail, Waka Flocka was huge. So, you know, I can see why he decided to... Oh, never mind. You know, Young Pharaoh believes that the black woman is God. And sometimes God disappoints you. So sometimes if you get disappointed, you know, you say things like, God damn it. Well, that's the same as Young Pharaoh calling a black woman a bitch. So if you use the Lord's name in vain, you can't judge Young Pharaoh for saying that the black woman is God, but then calling all his baby mothers and every woman that saw, you know. YouTube is a place for people to make up stories. You see, there's a lot of channel stories and people make up things, make up relationships. So, you know, at least Young Pharaoh has met all of his wives in person. And that's saying in this atmosphere and this surrounding.
You can't be eating candy, Crystal.
So, in closing, if you can't prove that Young Pharaoh isn't in the world, you can't say he's dumb. And just because he does drugs doesn't mean he's on drugs. So, with that being said, please, Sammy.
As you know, Denise is the girl who broke up with me 5 weeks ago. Wasn't that big a deal. She ripped open my chest and pulled out my heart. But it's fine, it's fine. Everything's okay. So let's move on with the show. Looks like we got a phone call. Hello?
State your name, where you're calling from, and how you feel about tonight's topic.
You heard it. I'm DK from Jersey.
Shout out to Jersey. How you doing, family?
Yeah, staying talk, baby. I'm with you.
All right, now. I appreciate that.
What do you think? Denise and I made a good couple?
Yeah, definitely.
I know. What's with her?
I don't know, man.
Okay, thanks for coming by, Daryl.
Thanks. I will beat your ass by this nigga on this FaceTime. Like, don't try to get fly because you got a nigga on the phone. Like, that's going to save you. He's going to see you get your ass beat. I don't hit with him, but I'm like, bitch.
DJ!
I can't believe she did this to me. It's not fair. What did I do wrong? Denise just told me, and I'm not doing it.
Hello, Brian. This is your father.
This episode was brought to you by At University, Young Pharaoh, Atten Technology, and a whole bunch of other somehow corporations that don't have any products. Okay.
Lord.
Corporations don't have any products.
Mm-hmm. But who is NK windmilling for next week?
Oh boy, I don't know. There's a lot of people to windmill for. I'm thinking we might windmill for men to get beat up by women.
Is that really something to windmill for?
I mean, it's, you know, male abuse is a real thing. There's a lot of battered men out there.
True, true.
So I'm gonna donate to a cause. But you know, back to this Black History Month, right? There was this whole thing, right? We always talk about the blood quantum laws, and we talk about people passing, and you know, maybe we don't really understand how deep that goes. Now there were, what was it? It was like 40,000 or 4,000. What was it?
What?
How many mixed people had they had estimated had left?
I believe they said 40,000.
something like that. It was a crazy amount of people that they had estimated had left the South and became various other
never to contact family and friends again.
Right. You know, people like you know, like they talk about J. Edgar Hoover.
Yeah.
They have come from that type of background.
But the thing that shocked me was he promised these people all this stuff and they didn't even have the freaking water rights. And these folks trusted them more than likely because it was a black guy.
They won't.
Went out there 1,000 and what, 325 returned?
Mm-hmm. The rest of them got died.
They died. Some of them, they don't know what happened to them.
Yeah, usually when you don't know what happened to people,
it usually means they died. Well, back then it didn't always mean they died.
Yeah, you know, in that period of time, you could kind of just leave and be somebody else.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, as history tells us, if you were light enough,
yeah,
you could just literally just be somebody else. And you know, there's a big history of that. Like there are black people who had said they were all kind of things.
Mm-hmm. You know? Yeah, they had a whole list.
But you know, a lot of that had to do with like, the location that you were in.
It said former slave who pretended to be a Mexican. I say, you know it. You fucking lying.
Nah, man. You know it. Nah, but you know the first thing I thought about, right?
Mm.
You remember when there was this whole big push about the pushing the immigration laws, right?
Yeah.
And talking about the people who were coming up were really, you know, really belonged in the country, and this is really their group, right?
Mm-hmm.
And there was the assumption that these people were, you know, of Native descent, right? Mm-hmm. Or speaking about the different territories when the Spanish had a territory in the South and in the West, and you know, et cetera, right? But we don't think about the fact that, you know, what if some of these people are descended from the slaves that ran away to Mexico?
That part,
you know. So. But people don't realize this, right? We often talk about the folks who escaped to the North and into Canada, right?
Mm-hmm.
Where the slave, you know, had slavery had been abolished long before America had abolished slavery, right?
Mm-hmm.
But the Spanish had also abolished slavery around 1812. So that meant that if you were able to cross the Rio Grande,
you was free.
You was free.
No catches, and no caveats. Free.
Right. There's no slave catchers coming to Mexico to come get you. You gone. Lawrence Dennis. I'm gonna look into that, B Buckingham.
Mm-hmm.
But you know, there's we end up in a lot of different movements and we have this idea that just because someone has black blood and they're passing, that they have to have, you know, they're a secret agent for black people.
Mm.
And that's not the case. As we see with Mr. Ellis, it kind of creates a duplicitous nature.
The Mexican government on using black and on importing black people over there to pick cotton.
Mm-hmm.
So basically, but,
you know, you got to look at the time. I'm not making any excuses. There's no windmilling for Mr. Ellis, but what I'm saying is that we have to dispel some of the romanticism, because Carl Jacoby in the book he's telling, they want to make a movie about this. They want to make William Ellis into like, someone a folk hero. Like, because the idea is that he escaped the system, he escaped the plan of poverty and you know, all these things that were meant for black people, right?
But how is that any better than the folk they condemned for passing as white? It ain't. It's the same thing. You have to pretend to be something else to get anywhere.
It's not. And in ways like this, right? If you think about a person that goes and passes white and just doesn't associate with black people whatsoever, that's a lot better than someone who passes as something other than white and then comes back to exploit black people.
Yeah, but what I'm saying is, like, they hold that up like they supposed to be doing all this big, great stuff. Last I checked, Malcolm X wasn't passing, Martin Luther King wasn't passing, you know, what? None of these other folk passing, but they did what they did. But they'll hold that up as an example because he was a con man. It was a whole confidence scam. Right. He scammed the Mexican government by making them think he was Mexican, and he scammed the black people by making them think he was black.
I mean, he was going to come save them.
And he basically fucked both ends.
Mm-hmm.
You're being bad.
But, you know, this is... It just... If we let go and dispel the romance out of things, right, then we can understand that this isn't a hero. Just because you beat the system, that doesn't make you a hero. Because there's going to be a day when people look back at Eugene and at Jermaine and at Jeannie and view them as people who weren't supposed to have anything, and they got to blow millions of dollars off the black community. And they'll look at that as a positive thing because they beat the system in someone's eyes. And this is the same kind of guy. Like, we don't have any evidence that he was an abuser of women or anything like that, but it's quite abusive to bring a bunch of black women and their children to another country.
Hold on, wait a minute. Didn't he leave his first family? Wasn't there a first wife or some children or something? Or am I misremembering?
I don't remember another wife. Was there another wife?
Could have been. I don't know. I thought
he had siblings. He left his siblings and he didn't have a family until the
white woman. Yeah, he married the white woman of humble. Yeah,
he did. He was like Charles Barkley a little bit. He kind of looked like Charles Barkley. But peace, Nequa. But we have, you know, we're remembering, you know, as we remember history, right?
Mm-hmm. Shadow.
We have to be able to look at people and view them beyond what we might think it meant or the symbolism of what they did, and look at it for what the reality of it is. And the reality of it is this wasn't a good guy.
At all.
You know what I'm saying? Escaping slavery is commendable. Escaping the idea, escaping the destiny that was set forth for black people in that period of time is commendable. But then doubling back, because he escaped that without exploiting black people.
Mm-hmm.
Just by changing his name and being known as a Mexican.
Yep, he had to do when they put C in the phone book, would move to another place,
right? Which he did,
yeah. Wall Street,
right?
Meek out there making chili and shit. I ain't gonna hate on your chili. You probably got piping hot bowls and bread and shit, little cheese sprinkled across the middle. Maybe some sour cream and some chives, depending on how freaky you feel in the night.
but yeah, you was about the video with the about the slaves. So there is a history of many slaves leaving the South. So we're gonna get into a little bit of that history. We're gonna use that for fair use purposes of education. So if this is your video, what we're doing is we're sharing this with our family here and hope that they go and subscribe to your channel. And if they find anything else interesting in your catalog of videos, that they support those things.
Yes, yes.
But fair use, fair use, fair use, fair use.
Let's go ahead and run that disclaimer real quick. Okay, here
think
we go.
About the Underground Railroad, you think of places like Canada, the northern United States. People think about the route going north and over. And for that reason, that's where a lot of escaped slaves went to when they escaped from slavery. Slavery was abolished in the entire British Empire in 1834. This included Canada, which was then part of the British Empire. However, many people do not know that a sizable amount of slaves escaped further south into Mexico. The state of Texas entered the Union as a slave state on December 29, 1845. It had been a country of its own for several years before that. Texas was the only slave state to border a country where slavery had been abolished. The Fugitive Slave Act of 1797 was passed. This required the return of escaped slaves back to the territory or state from which they escaped from. There were some jurisdictions in free states that refused to comply with this law. When the Fugitive Slave Act of 1850 was passed, this required the cooperation of citizens and officials to return escaped slaves back to their owners. The Underground Railroad would begin to flourish as a, not a railroad, but a network of houses and people that would help slaves escape to freedom. When it became apparent that even in free states, freedom wasn't always guaranteed, the goal would be escape to Canada. Canada was not the only place where slaves were escaping to. Mexico was another place where many slaves would escape to. Mexico had abolished slavery in 1829, and Texas bordering Mexico, many slaves knew about Mexico. With Mexico being closer, this made a relatively shorter route to freedom. There was an underground railroad going south from Texas into Mexico. There is geography to see here. With Texas being a lot closer to Mexico than to Canada, many slaves chose to go to Mexico. If you like this video, check out other videos on this channel. Be sure to hit the bell right next to the subscribe button so you can get notifications about more videos. And as always, be sure to leave a comment, like, and subscribe.
Shout out the Geo Scholar.
So yeah, I mean, this is something that we don't talk about, but we got a bunch of people now who are saying that the black people in Mexico are the Aboriginal people of the Americas.
But they left from the southern states with Corbry. See, I told
you. Yo,
did I not say
chili with cornbread yesterday? Sorry.
Ain't no problem.
It was amazing. I had flashbacks. It was amazing. Cornbread. But you know, we are adopting all of, you know, speaking about the importance of black history, right?
Mm-hmm.
A bunch of these scam artists are able to show up, you know, and I'm going to take it away from the scamming part, right? Because a lot of these people, the scam is not even in their minds, even the doctrine part. They believe the doctrine is true, right? Mm-hmm. And a lot of that comes from ignorance of history and a want not to be who you are. Yeah. And if you couple those two things, you get a bunch of followers of nonsensical things that get more and more nonsensical as they continue.
Yeah. Stretch
so
limits of belief until they stretch it so far they go past belief to straight. Anybody else looking at it is, I know you fucking lying.
Right. Like at some point they were starting to push the Harriet Tubman didn't exist. And the slaves were really just employees who didn't want to come to work.
Yeah, I saw that BS. He was like, I know. You know,
but this stems from the fact is these are things that people don't get, right? by the 1800s at least, a vast majority of slaves looked white.
Yes.
They were so mixed, they looked white. You know what I mean? Like, it was only that your mother was black, and we know you're a slave.
Hey, D-Red.
Right? So it wasn't like it was easily detectable. Pico? No, I have not. But it's not like there was like this always a staunch difference between who was black and who was white in the United States during that period of time.
Oh Lord, I dropped it.
Mm-hmm. But then we start adding in the fact that both white people and black people were marrying into native tribes, and natives were marrying into, you know, the black community. So when we talk about things and we romanticize,
it doesn't say forerunner. First off, it says predecessor. That means coming before. And since you just derailed, we've been doing this since February 1st. It is February 22nd, and here you are.
Oh, yeah. We talked to Bishop Turner. If you go back to, was Garvey a Pan-African? We talked about Turner. Yeah. We talked about Turner and the
Mittymore
Gordon discussion.
Some decades, then yeah, the title is right. Predecessor. Doesn't say forerunner. It says predecessor. Hey, Shabo.
Yeah. So when we're talking about predecessor, what you want to get into is like, was Garvey even a Pan-African?
That's not what we're
Garvey himself,
about.
Even for black people. And no, where Garvey and Ellis are connected, they are both two duplicitous Negroes who was willing to do whatever they had to get what they wanted for themselves. That's where the predecessory part comes from. So if there's any confusion, right? We don't hold anybody on a pedestal in here, especially if they wore a costume.
He should know that by now.
So if we talk about Garvey, I got more respect for Bishop Turner than I'll ever have for Garvey. Garvey was not a real Pan-African. Garvey was not really for black people. Garvey was a scam artist. Now, if we want to talk about people who were for black people, then I would talk about his wives. Would Garvey and Amy. Now, they were Pan-Africans. They were for black people, but their husband was not. That was just a nigga they used because nobody would listen to women in the 20s. Should I say that one more time?
You ain't been over here, I don't know how long. And the first thing
Garvey was a nigga.
Doing.
Garvey was nothing but a Garvey was a duplicitous scam artist. Two Pan-African women propped up in order to spread their ideas about politics, and Garvey used those ideas to scam, and it landed him in jail. And that woman was so dedicated to her husband and those ideas that to this day, her grandchildren are fighting to clean up his filthy name.
Filthy.
And if we got off the romance train and put the roses and the candies down and got into really trying to organize to do something, then we'd stop following these stuffed shirts and personalities telling you that they got the only answer. When we all got the answer.
I mean, doing his thing, he led 1,000 people off and only in less than half came back. But he doing his thing.
You know what I'm saying? Like what, like why should
over here for how many black people? And you know better than to come in here without saying hey first.
Shabo, peace. But you know, when we talk about opportunism, that same level of opportunism exists in the 2020s. So the same way that online, you can be whoever you want to be. You could change name. You could tell people you came from what?
See what she got.
The Sudan. You could tell people you came from another planet. You could tell people you were abducted by aliens and no one can prove it.
Back to Africa. See, D-Red, you come in arguing something we ain't even talking about. Take the all caps off and act civilized, please.
Why does the Black to Africa movement have anything to do with the Black to Africa movement didn't have anything to do with Garvey.
So don't say nothing else. Just wait on it. Okay. Why are you coming in here bringing up topics that aren't being spoken on right now? Because you don't like the presentation? Well, maybe just come in and say that. Don't come in here trying to trigger people and shit and all this other kind of mess.
Anyway, moving along. So we you have
each other entirely too long for you to come in here like that, D-Red. And that's disrespectful and rude. You know I don't do that over here, and you know I don't rock like that. But see, you won't answer nothing to that, but you'll answer back and forth about this Garvey stuff. That lets me know that you hear me. So hear me good. Keep right on, and you won't be welcome over here. And you know it takes a lot. It takes a lot. See, right, and forerunner and predecessor mean the same thing, but they both have different definitions. They go together in the thesaurus, yes, but some of the definitions might be a little bit different. Don't come in trying to argue semantics. You cut my ceiling fan off. Don't come in trying to argue semantics when you can't even say, hi, good evening, how are you? Ain't seen you in a while. None of that.
I'm trying to understand how a Pan-African could be a forerunner to someone who's not a Pan-African. So if Turner was a Pan-African, which I don't dispute, but understand that the you know, we already addressed this. So you may be making arguments that have already been debunked in the last video. So you should probably go back to the last video if you want to argue about Pan-Africanism. You should go to that video.
You come in and say what it do, but you ain't even say that this time, D-Red, and that's what I meant by, hey, once again, semantics. You came dead in talking about the topic. You usually say what it do, baby, or some at least acknowledge people. You jump right on what you wanted to jump on. No, that's cool, and that's what's up. You ain't got to explain something that simple to D-Red. He knows exactly what it means.
Shout out to Niqua. But
like I already
if
said,
if you went into the video, if you were interested, you would go back into the other video of was Garvey a Pan-African.
We came in arguing something we ain't even talking about, D-Red. First and foremost, you don't know what context we was using predecessor in because you were not here. You have not been here from the whole start of the series, which I said February 1st. You know, jumping in and out my chat. No.
Yeah, like, yo. All right. Like, as a man, I'm just going to ignore you because you're not even making no sense. So, as a man, I'm not even going to keep on giving you no attention, guys.
Well, he don't need no definitions. He know exactly what forerunner and predecessor means. Me and D-Red have always...
Like, as a man, like, you know that's weird. Like, you start an argument and now you're asking what we're talking about. I'm directly addressing everything you said, but you don't know what I'm talking about. Okay, you being weird. Okay, we got it.
It's a title, but it's a whole show. We've been on for an hour, and you come in talking about a title, and you don't know what's going on. You made an assumption, and you was wrong.
No, yeah, you're the type of person that when the article comes, you just read the headline and keep it moving.
What was going on? So you don't know what position we was taking. You just assume we was taking one and jump right in with that. I ain't tripping for shit. And you know I'm not.
Yo.
Like I said, we've been doing this since February 1st. It is the 22nd. Now you want to jump in and, and say something about the title. Really, D-Red? For real. So just fuck everything before, everything that was said in this live, and we just gonna go with the title.
I knew we should have called it Scam Daddy. The harder they scam or something, right? Would that have been better for you? The harder they scam? The Western tale of a scammer? Excuse me.
Always some silly stuff. Crystal, quit breathing all in my ear.
So, according to Nequa, Mr. Ellis held the job of a scammer in New York in the 1800s and Gard came in the 20s and 30s.
I was just going with the scam angle when I said
the whole purpose of the scams.
Predecessor to the scam, just
we talk about Polite over here, who's a scam artist.
Yeah, Rolls Royce Diary, but predecessor to the Rolls Royce Diary. It kind of coincides with the rest of the titles we've been running.
But yeah, it all fitted like the encyclopedia, or it's like watching Star Wars from the end.
Craig,
watching the Menace.
Craig. We good for Saturday?
It's like, imagine you come in and you've never seen a Star Wars movie and you see the Phantom Menace and like, why are you calling it Phantom Menace for? I didn't see any menaces or phantoms.
I mean, I love
you
it.
You don't, but now you're going to get to know me on, and I'm getting to know that you're not that bright.
I love it when people come over here and so you acknowledge so the mail like, on me, my platform.
I want my first impression of people to let people know that I'm not on no fuck shit and I'm not goofy. But you don't seem to care. So remember, the first impression goes two ways.
All of that was unnecessary when you came in, dude. You didn't even know what we was talking about. And that's usually what somebody does when they don't like the topic. We are hour in and you don't come in, you see? But I don't know what I'm talking about. I'm trying.
Well, when they like the topic, they don't show up at all. So, hey, what can you say?
That part.
But anyway. So we got about an hour in this.
Yeah, sure. We be back in a minute, family. This is Tripsy's Treehouse, where it's always swinging